Today and those that are joining us by Facebook Live this morning. So today is the second Sunday of Easter. It's the second resurrection appearance of Jesus to his disciples. They're in the upper room tomb, so to speak, and it's a good day to talk about myths and doubts as we encounter the doubting Thomas and his conversation with Jesus today. Our music today, special music, is from Jane. So Jane, thank you for sharing your gifts with us on piano and organ. And then I would simply mention along with that that Jane has put together a list of slots for music on Sundays all the way through June, July, and August, the upcoming summer. So if you would like to share a gift of music with us on one of those Sundays, there's a sign-up sheet in the back, or if you know someone, please ask them, and then we'll get them signed up for special music. A couple other things to note, we're looking for two council reps for our council this year, and then also part-time secretary position is still open, so if you are interested in applying or know someone that is, please let us know. The mission of the month right now is World Hunger, so your gift will help many hungry people, women, children, and men throughout the world. And your gifts and the globe offering, the Golden Buddy entryway, will go directly to trying to solve those problems and feed those people in our world. We have some birthdays to celebrate today, so let me read through the list here. Adam Schiller, Tyrese Wood, Jason Rickert, Courtney Jo Neal, Roger Quam, Randall Steiner, Sophie Epps, and Emily Faust. With those announcements said, let us begin our worship by singing together, Alleluia, Jesus is risen. Please stand.
Spoken. We praise you, O God, for you have given us joy and
sing, "Lord, I lift your name on high." We'll sing that through two times.
Thank you.
about every day on Facebook, on the church's Facebook page with her panel. So how many songs have you done over the past more than a year now?
It's been over 200.
Over 200 songs. If you have some children here today, we'd like you to come forward for just a brief moment together. All right, so I told them that we have had an experiment this morning. And what is this? The bending straw, yeah, it's a straw. What do you do with straws usually? Drinks? See, you stick this in the water, then what? Is it just going to happen? You have to kind of suck on that and pull the water out, right? So we're going to try an experiment here. I'll back up when I do this. Just pull my mask down a little bit. So here we go. See if it's going to work. Yeah, I got some water up there. What happens if I blow the other way? Whoa! It kind of exploded on me. You see those bubbles? Why is there bubbles in there? I'm blowing in the water, right? Okay, what do you think, girls? It doesn't just happen by sticking out in there. You gotta take a breath. Can you take a deep breath? And blow out. With a face mask on, you can't really tell that you're blowing out, right? That's what happens. So today, our story is about Jesus seeing the disciples in this room upstairs. Do you have an upstairs room in your house? Bedroom? Do you have to walk up some stairs? Yep, so you walk up the stairs, they're in this room. We don't know inside what it looked like, but we just know they were in an upper room in a house. And they're really worried. They have a lot of fear inside of them. Do you guys ever get afraid? So what are some of the things you might be afraid of? I don't like spiders. Snakes? I'm not afraid of snakes so much anymore, but used to be. But I'll tell you, the one thing that really gets me anxious is ticks. Do you ever get a tick on you? Yeah. So one time I was fishing with some buddies, and it was just about this time here, maybe more into the month of May, and we were catching lots of fish. I mean, we caught 150 bullheads that day, so that's a lot of fish. And a couple of buddies of mine. And I looked down, and I was covered with ticks. And I bet I had 40 to 50 ticks on me. So ever since then, I've been really afraid of ticks. And then when I was working at camp in the summer in college, I got tick fever, and I got really sick. So that's why I'm afraid of ticks. So if there was a tick in your head, I'd be really nervous. I want to get that off your head as soon as I can, right? The disciples were really afraid because Jesus had died on the cross. And they kind of wondered in their hearts, well, if we talk about Jesus, if we say that we're his disciples, his followers, then maybe we will get crucified on the cross. So they were really afraid. They're in this upper room. They're filled with fear. Jesus suddenly walks through the walls of that room, resurrected Jesus, and he blows on them, breathes on them, and he says, receive the Holy Spirit. Can you do that? Let's just breathe out. Say that word. Receive the Holy Spirit. Just like this water. What happened to that water when I blew hard in there? Came spilling out, right? So we have to believe as children of God that God is going to breathe into us when we're afraid, and he's going to blow all that fear out of us. So that's what we're looking at today in the lessons. Now there's a little craft that you can do at home. And I'm going to give some of this away here. So you just take a little piece of paper, draw a heart, cut it out, and then you can take that heart and do a few things with that. So I had a little fun. I put the words, I believe, because when Jesus breathes into us, Just for that here, then we have belief. We have faith, right? Faith. I'm not afraid anymore. I believe because God is with me. You can put the words I believe and I use some sprinkles, sparkling sprinkles.
Yeah.
And then you can take some ribbon and you can tie it on there and hang it up in your room maybe. But in the middle of this, I have a hand. And what's on that hand? What do you see on that hand? A dot. Part of the story, I want you to listen to the gospel reading today. Listen really close because they're afraid. And there's this disciple called Thomas. He says, I'm not going to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. I'm not going to believe that person who just walked through the doors and walked through the walls of Jesus unless I put my finger in the nail prints in his hand because he was nailed on the cross. He must have some wounds there. So that hand is to remind us. Jesus says, Thomas, put your hand here. Put your hand in my side where I was wounded. And know that it's the physical Jesus here. I am risen from the dead. And he says, have faith, Thomas. Don't doubt, but believe. So, you want to take that home with you? And here's a couple of the parts you can work on some crafts at home. You can do the same thing, okay? So let's have a prayer now. We'll have everybody that's in the congregation see these, repeat these words with me. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for the gift of Jesus.
Thank you for the gift of Jesus.
Who reminds and teaches us how.
Who reminds and teaches us how.
To breathe in your spirit.
To breathe in your spirit.
That replaces our fear.
That replaces our fear.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, thanks for coming up, guys. We turn now to the readings of the scripture for the day. The first lesson is from the book of Acts, the fourth chapter, verses 32 to 35. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson is from Book of Psalms, the 133rd chapter. How wonderful and pleasant it is when brothers live together in harmony. For harmony is as precious as the anointing oil that was poured over Aaron's beard, that ran down his beard and onto the border of his robe. Harmony is as refreshing as the dew from Mount Hermon that falls on the mountains of Zion. And there the Lord has pronounced his blessing, even life everlasting. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the Alleluia verse. Jesus entered, stood among them, and said, peace to you. And then he showed him his hands and his side. The disciples, seeing the master with their own eyes, were awestruck. Jesus repeated this greeting, peace to you, just as the Father sent me, so I send you. And then he took a deep breath, and he breathed into them. See the Holy Spirit, he said, if you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? But Thomas, sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, we saw the master. But he said, unless I see the holes in his hands, put my finger in the nail holes, and stick my hand in his side, I won't believe it. Now, 8 days later, the disciples were again in the room. This time, Thomas was with them. Jesus came right through the locked doors and stood among them and said, "Peace to you." And then he focused his attention on Thomas. "Take your finger, Thomas, and examine my hands. Take your hand and stick it in my side. Don't be unbelieving. Believe." Thomas said, "My master, my God." And Jesus said, "So you believe because you have seen with your own eyes? Even better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing." Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. These are written down so that you might believe Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and in the act of believing have real and eternal life in the way he personally revealed it. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. As human beings, I believe that we're all fascinated by mystery, one way or the other. So let's try a few of these out this morning. Why does there have to be a coronavirus anyway? We've all been pondering that. How did it get started? Where did it come from? I received word from a colleague a while back, a few years ago. He started forgetting things. He had to look at his driver's license to figure out what his name was. He had a feeling that he had children, but he couldn't remember any names. He got mixed up and forgot parts of the worship liturgy during the Sunday service. And it was almost like he had a stroke. He went on 100% disability. It's a mystery why that happened. But this one, why do sandhill cranes land on the Platte River bottom in Nebraska this time of year as opposed to anywhere else? And people from the world over come to see this display of sandhill cranes. What is it? Why do they land there? Is it the long, winding Platte River Valley? Or maybe it's something in the soil. It's a mystery. Why do pomegranates have so many seeds in them? Why does an avocado have such a large pit? You ever thought about that? It took a while, for a time at least, but scientists were perplexed by gravity and where it came from and how it happened. Or this one. Why do some people live longer than others? You ever figure that out? Our oldest members here at St. Ansgar's Lutheran Church are approaching, and some have surpassed, 100 years old. How does that happen? On the lighter side, we can use things like this. Why is the grass always greener on the other side of the hill? Why is it that only winter green certs, you know those certs that you can suck on and chew and give you good breath, breath smells good? Why do those winter green flavored certs, of all the certs, why is it the only one that sparkles when you chew it? Now I know you're going to go out and get some of them and try it. Why is sign language pretty much recognizable the world over? Why is there only one word for thesaurus? Why does a person press harder on a remote when you know that the battery is dead? You keep pressing the remote, right? Pretty soon you throw it against the wall. How does the man who drives a snowplow get to work? Ever thought about that? It's a mystery. That's why we have this attraction to shows like Mythbusters. I used to love to watch that show. Either the myth that they're testing is true, or as they find out through the testing, it doesn't hold water. And therefore, according to the name of that show, the myth is busted. The world is cloaked in mystery, and you can either learn to live with it or work to uncover the truth and it no longer remain in the dark. Agreed? You and I share an affinity with followers like Thomas today, just like us. The Easter season is shrouded in mystery. Take the resurrection. The Apostle Paul says it this way, "Lo, I tell you a mystery. We will not all die, but we will all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable. And we will all be changed. This perishable body will put on imperishability. This mortal body puts on immortality." Resurrection, it's a mystery. Ascension, what about that? This is when, in the Bible story, we learn how Jesus ascends into the heavens. Now, the Old Testament had the story of Elijah also ascending into heaven. Jesus ascends into the heaven. He rises into the heaven. So how did that happen? We're dumbstruck, not able to speak, shocked, awed. We stand there gawking at the sky, and we begin to wonder what this is all about, what it could possibly mean, how did it happen? And these angelic beings come in close to us in white robes, and they ask, "Why do you stand there gawking at the heavens?" It's a mystery. There's work to do. Ascension. It's a mystery. The disciples go back to the tomb where Jesus was laid. But the grave is empty. It's a mystery. The linen cloths that were laying there, just as they had been placed on Jesus' body after he had died on the cross and was taken down and put on the cross, from being put on the cross and laid in a tomb. And they're right there, but Jesus is not there. It's a mystery. Jesus walks almost imperceptibly, invisibly through the walls of that upper room. Call it a tomb today. He appears out of nowhere. Jesus talks with them. He eats with them. Jesus has a physical structure in resurrection. It's not some kind of mystical, mysterious body. It's Jesus' body. But he also has a spiritual nature. The followers can comprehend what he says. They hear him and they respond to his voice. He commands an answer. It commands their attention, but it's a mystery. The gospel text for today is one of those Easter mysteries. The followers are locked in the upper room. They're afraid. They're filled with despair, discouragement, wondering what to do. They're at a loss for what to do, doubting, suspicious, questioning. Thomas is with them. But he's not the only one locked in this tomb. Now, we talked about this last week at Easter. In Mark, anyway, Mark 16, verse 8, as the gospel originally ended, as the women finding the tomb empty and running away, being terrified and filled with fear. You get the feeling that you've been down this road before. This is the second time Jesus appears in that upper room. Thomas wants to bust the myth. Can it be true, he asks. He's pressing for answers to one of Easter's greatest mysteries. And Thomas's words become our words. "Unless I see the mark of the nail in your hands, Jesus, I will not believe. Unless I put my finger in the mark of your side where you were wounded, I will not believe." Thomas is not alone. Herod, you might recall, in the Passion narrative according to the Gospel of Luke, and the chief priests and scribes and Pharisees also say to Jesus, "We wish to have a sign." Theologian Karl Barth summed up these myth-busting, mystery-seeking questions with these words. "Doubt," he says, "has its time and its place. And in the present, no one can escape it." No one can escape the doubt. Hebrews 11 tells us, "Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen." And in 1 Corinthians, we hear, "The foolishness of God is wiser than human beings, and the weakness of God is stronger than human beings." Even the reformer Martin Luther said, unless I am convinced with Scripture for the right reason, I neither can nor will recant anything, since it is neither right nor safe to act on what he called my conscience. Here's how Jesus handles our mysteries. Listen in. Jesus gave Thomas a second chance. That's worth noting in the biblical record. Second chance. We do have a God of second chances. And thirds, fourths, fifths, and sixths to go on. Thomas missed the first sighting of Jesus. He had to lay his own eyes on Jesus. So Jesus comes a second time to the upper room for Thomas. Jesus gives second chances. Jesus greets his followers and he says, peace to you. Peace be with you, he says. He says that three times in the text. This is also worth noting, how Jesus greets us in the midst of that fear and doubt. And then Jesus touches his disciples. He touches them. He says to Thomas, Thomas, put your hand here in the nail prints in my hands. So what happens? Thomas takes his physical hand and touches Jesus' physical wounded hand. He says to Thomas, place your hand in the wounded scar in my side. So Thomas does. Jesus has a physical nature as well as a spiritual nature. And furthermore, Jesus breathes on them like that straw in that water, right? Now, I don't know when the last time was that someone breathed on you, but this is really proof of the pudding, isn't it? We've all been wearing masks, but if you take that mask down and someone breathes on you, you feel that breath. You know something is happening there. Sometimes we think of the breath of God as the chill running down our spine. Did that ever happen to you? Happened to me once when I was out running 4 a.m. in the morning. It was really dark. And as I started running, there was another runner sitting on a park bench, tying his shoes, getting ready to run, and it sent a chill right down my spine. And I'm sure that it sent a chill right down the other runner's spine. And I told my fellow runners that morning, I'd seen the man in the bright raiment that morning. Jesus gives us second chances. Jesus greets us with peace. Jesus touches us. Jesus breathes on us. And we have no better response in the midst of Easter's mysteries but to join Thomas and fall on our knees and confess with Thomas, my Lord and my God. But Jesus ends the episode with these words. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. Let me close with a few short stories to keep you scratching your head about what that could possibly mean. Many of you may be aware that I enjoy the occasional backpacking trek. Every few years it seemed over the course of my life, in the last 2 or 3 decades, my backpacking buddy and I will gather up enough courage and strength to go out and say, begin a trek of 125 miles. Seems kind of daunting to start with, but break it down and it works. On this particular stretch of the trail we were on, it was supposed to be marked clearly with, you know, trail marker signs. And in that particular area, it was these long, skinny, brown signs. Now, why did they paint it brown? I don't know. I suppose to not distract people when they're out in the wilderness. You want to keep it pretty, right? These long, skinny, fiberglass brown signs. They're not going to deteriorate because they're fiberglass. And they had the number 89 on them, and they had this kind of symbol or image of a buffalo on them. So you kind of knew where you were going if you could find the signs. Well, the signs were made of fiberglass, and I suppose we're thinking they would stay upright and clearly mark the trail for a long time. The only thing is, they forgot about the wildlife. That part of the world is filled with buffalo and deer and elk and antelope. And they would also like to take trails like we were taking, and at a certain time of year, they had to begin rubbing on something. Like buffalo, they have to rub to get rid of that fur that they've been carrying all winter long. And sure enough, they love to rub on the fiberglass signs. So a lot of those signs lay broken down in the treks we were on. On this particular backpack outing that day, it actually happened more than once in more than one location, we simply lost our way, lost the trail. I wanted to go one way, and my backpacking friend wanted to go the other. I said, "This way." And he said, "No, this way." The trail is so hard to follow, and there was no one around to help. I just have to tell you, we had a hard time not seeing and yet believing that we were on the right trail, that we were headed in the right direction. I was probably more panicked because I knew I required more water to drink in those hot summer backpacking days than my backpacking partner did, and we were running out of water. And I would surely pass out by the end of the day's trek. But we put our heads together. We believed the trail was there somewhere, and sure enough, we found those signs laying in the field where we were looking. Got back on the path. A gentleman once told me about his flight training, his instrument rating flight test for a commercial airplane. He said he had to take off, fly the plane, and land the plane totally by instruments, not by sight. Sounds easy until they fit you with a large head visor, he said, that completely inhibits your window view. During the exam, he said his senses and logic informed him that he was in the negative position. And several times, his logic informed him that he was about to crash and burn. But his instruments, even though he could not see, brought him to the runway safely. Not seeing and believing may be one of the hardest things that you and I have to do in life. They say the human ear can detect sound frequencies upwards of 20,000 decibels, say, while dogs can detect sound at 30,000 frequency. Dog trainers will tell you you can blow a whistle that is in the 30,000 range. It will be silent to your ear, but it will be heard by the dog's ears. It's a mystery. Belief, truth, and conscience, as Luther called it, is like this. We cannot believe everything with simple myth-busting, trial-and-error, good old human logic methods. Belief simply comes by God uncovering the mystery for us each time, and we call this faith or belief. A final story. One of the more profound stories that I've read in recent years was a story put out by Pace Butler Corporation that had a lot to do with mentoring a man who had gotten in trouble with the law and who had a significant leader who came to his rescue in a sense and nurtured him into becoming success himself. So listen in. The man had done time in prison for something which, as the case is in most instances, for which he was guilty. You can imagine no one really believing in this young man or his future because there really was no future laid out there before him. But along comes a stranger in the prison setting. The incarcerated man went to this big meeting first because he had heard about it and then because it was a place to spend time other than his jail cell, away from the normal rigors of prison life. But then sooner or later, after engaging a heartfelt, soul-searching conversation with the visitor to the prison, the incarcerated man came to the meeting because he had homework to do and because he wanted to go. You see, unseen to everyone, really except the prisoner visitor, the incarcerated man was beginning to change. Little by little, on the outside first, breaking up and down that hard road in life, thinking he can't get through to the man or through life, breaking through that hard core exterior, and then eventually breaking through the inside of that man. And before long, the incarcerated had done his time, and he was released. It was something like 2 a.m. in the morning. Can you believe that prisoners are released at 2 a.m. in the morning? Where are they going to go? And all he had was a shirt on his back, shoes on his feet. The released man wondered what he was going to do next. No one was there to meet him, not a dime to his name. And then he remembered the directions. The prisoner had given him for the day that he got released. He said to the prisoner, "Meet me at such and such time at daybreak at the park." That's what the visitor had told him. So he did. The released man met the visitor, and another man came along, and they began to run. And they ran, and they ran, and they ran. Can you believe they made the released man run hours at a time? It seemed like an eternity to him. It was really something like 2 hours running nonstop. All told, probably 8 to 10 miles when they were done. And then the prison visitor took the released man home, gave him a job, and the upshot of the whole story, staring at 4 walls inside a prison incarcerated, it's hard to not see and believe. But someone did believe in that man. End of the story, the mentor, the prison visitor, the leader taught the released man how to start his life all over again, to start his own business. And he did. Through hardware, he purchased his own equipment and is the head of the company today. Remember how Jesus said that today, the second Sunday of Easter? "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." Easter mysteries. Real, confirmed, or busted. Amen. Let's stand and sing our song together. Hallelujah, we sing your praises.
The Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord of all creation, Lord of the empty tomb, we marvel at the work of your hands and yet are often frustrated at the frailty of our own hands as we endeavor to put your will for us into action. We pray for your church, constantly adapting to the ever-changing world while striving to hold on to and proclaim what is timeless and universal. Help us, your followers, to never lose the vision of establishing your kingdom here on this earth, and to seize every opportunity to speak boldly of your resurrection to your life and salvation. We thank you and pray for those who, in following your example, show concern and compassion to others. May those who give up their love to others know of your unending love in their own lives also. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray, God, for peace in your world. We pray for a just and lasting peace throughout the earth. We pray that people can draw inspiration from your life and so restore harmony where there once was discord and conflict. We pray for our nation, especially for those in national, state, county, and city governments, faced with the task of making difficult decisions which will affect us all. We pray that they will work together for the good of all with wisdom, integrity, and humility. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
And Lord Jesus, comforter and healer, to those in physical, mental, or spiritual need, we bring before you those known to us personally who are in need at this time. We name before you those who have asked for our prayers, as well as those known in our hearts that your healing touch will be felt in their lives. We continue to pray for Angie Lee, Chuck Drometer, Ashley Harry, Patsy Davidson, Richard and Jan Gerke, Sharon Doctor, Andrea and Mitch Deacon Jones, Benji Otto, Brad Hall, Ione Tomasetti, Melvin Jr. Johnson, Deb Pierce, Karen Rapp, Judy Johnson, Jerry Erickson, Jan Hall, Don Detling, and Aaron, and the family of Aaron Simonson. Darlene Sundheim as well. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunities to offer support and comfort to the bereaved. So we pray for those who face that pain of grief at the loss of a loved one as well. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our prayer. Risen Lord, as we go out into the world, we ask no more than you to walk with us and to open our eyes to the vision you have for each of us and to breathe your resurrection spirit into us. So accept these prayers this day that we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Let's share together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now the God of all grace, who has called you to eternal glory of Christ, restore, support, strengthen, and bless you by the power of God's Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Go in peace. Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.
And let's sing one more time another Hallelujah song. Oh, sons and daughters, let us sing.